From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice. Here's your host.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA Clinical Review podcast. I am Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA. Today, I'm here with Dr. Caroline Siegel, who is Assistant Professor of Medicine at Weill Cornell Medical College and Assistant Attending Physician at Hospital for Special Surgery. And we'll be talking about Dr. Siegel's JAMA Narrative Review on the topic of systemic lupus erythematosus. Welcome, Dr. Siegel, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So let's get started. Could we start by having you talk about what exactly is systemic lupus erythematosus and who is at risk for it?
Systemic lupus erythematosus, which for the purposes of this conversation I'll refer to as lupus, is a systemic autoimmune condition. It can affect nearly any organ in the body, and the specific manifestations really vary considerably among patients and can evolve significantly even over the course of an individual patient's disease. In terms of who is at risk, in general, women are much more likely to develop lupus than men, and lupus is also more common among certain racial and ethnic groups, including Black, Asian, and Hispanic people compared to non-Hispanic white people. Lupus can present at any age, but it does most commonly present during the late adolescent years through sixth decade of life or so. So often patients will present in their 20s, 30s, 40s, but really anyone is at risk for lupus. These are some demographic factors that make it a little bit more likely.
What are the typical presenting features of lupus?
Some of the more common presenting symptoms of lupus include rashes, joint pain and swelling, and hair loss. Also, findings in the lab work, such as low white blood cell count, low platelets, can be a common initial presentation as well.
So for patients presenting in primary care with possible lupus, it sounds like the generalist should order a complete blood count, a comprehensive chem panel, and an ANA. Do you recommend that the generalists order other autoantibody tests?
So when a general physician is thinking about a diagnosis of lupus, basic laboratory testing, including a complete blood count, complete metabolic panel, would be standard. But then beyond that, generally the initial screening test for lupus is the anti-nuclear antibody or ANA test. So that could be performed in the primary care setting.
And can we talk about the ANA for a moment? Because I believe there's a false positive rate that's pretty high. So what is that false positive rate? And when should somebody suspect a diagnosis of lupus in the setting of an elevated ANA?
Yes. So the ANA test is extremely sensitive for a diagnosis of lupus, but it's not as specific. And that sensitivity and specificity are greatly impacted also by the titer level. So at a higher titer level, the specificity is relatively higher. With a low titer positive ANA, it's very sensitive, again, but not so specific.
So you said at a higher ANA titer, the diagnosis of lupus is more likely. Is there a threshold that you tend to use? If it's above this level, then lupus should be suspected.
In terms of published classification criteria for lupus, the titer threshold for an ANA is 1 to 80. So with an ANA level of 1 to 40, below 1 to 80, one wouldn't be considered for a classification with lupus. But in the clinical context, there's no hard cutoff for considering a diagnosis of lupus. It's just that as the titer level gets higher, that specificity is notably higher. So at a low titer, it's still worth considering in the appropriate clinical context, but really important to rule out alternative diagnoses.
Do you recommend that generalists order other types of autoimmune antibodies, one of those panels, for example?
As a general rule, I don't recommend that general physicians need to go beyond the ANA necessarily. I think in the appropriate clinical context, when someone is considering a diagnosis of lupus and then finds that the ANA is positive, which further supports that possibility, at that point, it could be appropriate to refer to a rheumatologist for further evaluation.
And how is the diagnosis of lupus actually made?
Yeah, it's a great question. It can be really challenging to diagnose lupus, again, because of how heterogeneous the presentation can be. But in general, the diagnosis is made really on the basis of a combination of symptoms, that are suggestive, physical exam findings, and lab abnormalities that can be characteristic of lupus, and also when other potential etiologies have been ruled out. So in terms of those lab abnormalities, other than the positive ANA, most patients with lupus do have one or more additional autoantibodies. Many will have one or more cytopenias, as I mentioned, and low complement levels are also common and supportive of a diagnosis. So we have to sort of put all those factors together to make a diagnosis and rule out alternative explanations for the various symptoms.
Is there a symptom or a physical exam finding that is particularly common when someone's first presenting with lupus?
When patients initially present, they can also present with many different symptoms. I would say that joint symptoms, pain and swelling in the joints, rashes, and hair loss are very common as the initial presentation, especially to a general physician. It's common for patients to have incidental findings of lab abnormalities such as cytopenias, markers of kidney dysfunction that may suggest lupus nephritis. And all these things might bring a patient to medical attention and referral to a rheumatologist for further evaluation.
You mentioned that joint pain is one of the initial symptoms. I wondered, when people with lupus present for the first time and they present with joint pain, for those with lupus, is it typically certain joints? And also, would the generalist expect to see some findings on clinical examination associated with joint pain or not?
So when people with lupus present initially with joint complaints and joint pain, it is more common that this will be in the small joints of the hands, in a symmetrical distribution, hands and wrists, although it can impact any joint. And while sometimes it can be quite subtle and there may not be observable swelling on exam, it's certainly more supportive of an autoimmune inflammation in the joints if there's tenderness to palpation in the joint, swelling detected on exam. Patients may also complain of morning stiffness that typically lasts 30 minutes or greater, and these features lend further support to considering an autoimmune etiology and specifically lupus, again, if there's other factors to suggest that lupus may be the diagnosis.
So once the diagnosis has been made, what is first-line therapy?
In general, hydroxychloroquine is considered first-line therapy for systemic lupus. It's universally recommended for patients with lupus for various reasons. It's been shown to decrease disease activity, prevent future flares of disease, and treatment with hydroxychloroquine is also associated with improvements in long-term morbidity and mortality.
So is that a drug that patients typically stay on for lifetime?
Many patients with lupus will stay on hydroxychloroquine long-term. Whether or not it needs to be continued indefinitely, for example, for a patient with long-standing, very stable disease, is one that we don't know the answer to and is under active investigation. But yes, long-term treatment with hydroxychloroquine is generally recommended and standard.
And do you have an estimate, like what proportion of people that will be sufficient and the remainder need to go on to additional treatment?
I don't know if I can give you an estimate about that, just again, because of how variable the disease can be. So some patients can, through their whole disease trajectory, really have mild manifestations of disease, such as joint symptoms, skin rash, and not much else, whereas others may have inner organ involvement, kidney disease, heart involvement, et cetera, that will require more immunosuppressive therapies.
Does lupus ever self-resolve without treatment or after a period of treatment?
Patients with lupus can certainly enter long periods of remission or disease quiescence, but it is considered a chronic inflammatory condition where, at least currently, we don't really see patients being cured of their disease, but they can have long periods of stability.
What are some of the newer therapies for lupus?
In recent years, there have been several new therapies made available for the treatment of both lupus and specifically for lupus nephritis. So belimumab, which is a monoclonal antibody therapy that blocks B-cell immunity, has been available for some time, over a decade, for the treatment of active non-renal lupus, but was more recently approved for lupus nephritis specifically. So that is available for use in conjunction with other standard therapies, so hydroxychloroquine and typically mycophenolate. In addition, voclosporin is a calcineurin inhibitor that received recent approval for treatment also specifically for lupus nephritis and also in combination with background therapies that I mentioned. And anifrolumab is also a biologic therapy that was recently approved for the treatment of active non-renal lupus. So this is a monoclonal antibody that blocks type 1 interferon and has been shown to be especially effective for treating active skin disease.
Can you tell us about the role of steroids like prednisone for treating lupus?
Yes. So steroids have many short and long-term adverse effects. We do aim to minimize their use to whatever extent is possible, and our guidelines really advocate for minimizing the dose and duration of steroids when possible. However, they do play an important role in treating lupus. So systemic steroids are often used in the short term to treat disease flares, and in some cases to bridge a patient to maintenance immunosuppressive therapies that may take much longer to take effect than steroids, which are more immediate in their effect.
And your review talks about the association between lupus and risk of cardiovascular disease and cancer. I wondered if you could tell us a little bit about that.
Many studies have shown that people with lupus have a significantly higher risk of cardiovascular disease compared to people without lupus. There are many factors that can contribute to this. These factors may include the effects of the disease itself, the longstanding inflammation and immune dysregulation that is associated with having lupus, and also in some cases, the effects of cumulative steroid exposure and related comorbidities there. In terms of the increased risk of malignancy with lupus, studies have found an increased risk of some malignancies in people with lupus, not all. And this association is also likely multifactorial. So the effects of chronic inflammation, again, also long-term treatments with immunosuppressive therapies and various other genetic and environmental factors that may disproportionately impact people with lupus likely play a role here.
And are there certain cancers that are most common, or is it across the board?
Studies have varied somewhat in terms of the risk of various malignancies in people with lupus compared to those without. In general, the risk of any malignancy is found to be higher in people with lupus, and specifically, the risk of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma has consistently been shown to be higher in people with lupus. Studies have also shown an increased risk of cervical dysplasia in people with lupus compared to people without.
Thanks for listening. This is Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA, and I've been speaking today with Dr. Caroline Siegel about her JAMA review on the topic of systemic lupus erythematosus. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thank you for listening.